So we're going to make sure that you can introduce yourself. And the biggest thing that I want to make sure that everybody thinks of when they're networking, what you're really doing is you are advocating. You are advocating for yourself. But I'm going to teach you a four-step concept that really will allow you to advocate for anything or anybody. By that I mean that I could advocate for my own career skills. I could advocate for a company that, like I could advocate for Amphenol, the company that I used to work for, so you can advocate for a company. You can advocate for a cause that you care a lot about. All right? So any of you that are involved in any kind of philanthropic or nonprofit causes that you care about, the model that I'm going to teach you is an advocation model that is useful in all these fashions, okay? So first, listen to my introduction, and you're going to hear pieces that I'm going to teach you to use. My name is Sue Reynolds, my company is Newmarket Careers, and I provide career coaching, job search assistance, resume writing and editing to managers, executives, and senior level professionals so that they can secure better jobs, negotiate better salaries, that they can knock down, drag out great career success. And I particularly come to this with 25 years of experience in career coaching, in particular that I have a communications degree and that I was a corporate speechwriter for Allied Chemical. So because I have that background and experience, it's led me into community relations, like I'm on the board of Chamber of Commerce, I'm on the board of Seroptimist here in town, which is an international women's group, and the Education Foundation, and active in other ways like Junior Achievement. So that's why I feel that my expertise is very pertinent to what I do as a career professional. Now, here are the steps that you heard me just go through. First of all, I introduced myself with my name, my whole name, my first and last name, not just, hi, my name is Sue. Welcome to the world of the professional workforce. Please, it is a pet peeve of mine if I do one thing with you folks today. Introduce yourselves with your first and last name proudly. Do not be, hi, my name is Sue. Okay? First and last name. With a good handshake, with great eye contact. Always, always, always. Now, some people have rejoined me that, well, you know, maybe I'm worried about security or something that I don't want to use my last name. I'm sorry. No, 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 no. Be a professional. I mean, Ed, could we ever consider ourselves a chamber introducing ourselves without our first and last names? I almost just can't conceive it. Right?
No.
So, your first and last name. Then, you heard me start out with number one. I told you the services that I provide. Okay? So I would like you to take, everybody got pencil and paper right now? Take a few minutes.
I have a question.
Sure.
How come you didn't address me as Ed Bernstein?
That's how you would introduce yourself to me. Now, hi, I'm Ed Bernstein. I would not say, hi, I'm Sue. Yeah.
I was kidding. Yeah, I'm sure you were.
There's one in every crowd. So now, that you write down the services that you provide. Write down the capabilities that you can bring to the table in your job search. So if you are a financial professional, accounts payable, accounts receivable, payroll, are you a real estate salesperson? So you provide sales and customer development, and I want the skill set you bring, the services that you provide, and take a few minutes and write that down. I'm proud to say I've actually had people like following me around the seminar today, and I've had some people like, wait a minute, I've already watched you talk about this. So the services that you can provide. So you heard me say, I'm Sue Reynolds and I provide job search assistance, career coaching, executive coaching. That was me kind of listing the services, okay? The next thing for you to inventory is the target audience that you would perceive would utilize the services that you provide. The target audience, these would be the kinds of companies, the kinds of individuals, maybe something about their demographics. It might be an age group, it might be a size of company, it might be a certain industry that you need to specifically target. Like in one of my earlier sessions, there's a gal that has just finished her nursing degree. So obviously her target is the healthcare industry, hospitals, extended care facilities, physical therapy. So she can talk about the target audience of the healthcare industry. So everybody write down what you think your target audience is. Now some people, like for instance some of the IT people, they might say, well, my target audience is everybody because everybody's using a computer. Well, that's a little bit too broad, and I would submit to you that you're not going to get away with it. If you aren't able to define some kind of differentiation, then your listener is not going to find the means of relating to who you're talking about. And they're certainly not going to be able to help you get in contact with them. Because your goal in being able to introduce yourself effectively is that you meet and influence people that would then be able to utilize your services, or that they could refer you to people that you need to know. So for her as a nurse, I want Ed to say, I'm going to pick Ed, that's my fabulous car out here. I want Ed to say, oh my gosh, yeah, my sister is the head of nursing at Mayo. Here, let me help you get in touch with her. So you have to be able to define audiences. And what's your question there, Ryan?
Well, one of the problems that I've found is I went through my bachelor's and then went straight and got my MBA.
Right.
So I just got out of school. Yeah. Yeah. Don't have a ton of job experience,
right.
Part-time work,
yeah.
Here and there.
Yeah.
So it's hard for me to really pinpoint certain services or target audience.
Yeah.
Where I don't know exactly what industry I want to be. I'm trying to kind of figure that out.
Things that I would do if I were your career coach is I would certainly start out with some of your, like, what was your emphasis inside
management.
You were in management. Okay.
Right.
So now, do you have any inclination of whether or not do you want to be in a business-to-business / industrial commercial type of management, or do you want to be in retail or consumer?
Okay.
Do you have that idea yet?
Probably more of a retail type.
Consumer types of industry. So there, see, we've started to narrow things down a little bit. But then in your back of your mind, it's like, but I don't want to eliminate it.
Right.
So here's what happens for you. You're making a strategic decision for yourself. Every time that you define an industry more narrowly, then that will either screen out people's understanding or that you were so broad. For instance, in one of my other sessions, there was a gal who was specifically in, yeah, hold on, there was a gal that was specifically in the healthcare industry. And so, and much of her brand, like she was a communications professional, a branding type of person. And so she chose in her commercial to say that she specializes in marketing in the healthcare industry. So she was making the strategic decision to say, I'm going to narrow myself this way. Just like you heard me narrow myself by saying, I do managers and supervisors. Well, like, can I help a guy right out of school? Yeah, but 90% of my business is this. So then you're making that strategic decision. So now for you, again, positioning yourself as a young MBA, you're going to be very well served by carefully itemizing what your skills and abilities are.
Have to go through.
Yeah. So and think about, well, I really like this course, so okay, I'm going to be really good with marketing stuff. I'm going to be and use your education, because yeah, you guys that don't have work experience, you can still market very, very effectively.
Yeah, okay. That's been one of my problems. It's too broad, saying, well, I got out of school and I'm looking for something.
I want to be in business.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Businessman. Right. So the target next here, the results that you create, the benefits. The outcome. All right? This is the thing they have because they've hired you and are working with you. This is what they've got as a result. Okay? So the service would be, I provide resume help. The outcome is that they've got a better job and negotiated more effectively and are off on a great career, right? That's the outcome. So all of you need to write down, well, if somebody hires you and you're doing your work for them, what will they then have because they worked with you? So for instance, my nurse in the other class, we talked about that she would have that the patients would be very safe and comfortable, that the medication would have been delivered accurately, the families were calm and well served, and thus the hospital was not, I don't know,
sued,
exactly, right? So there's the outcome. Everybody got some outcomes written down for themselves? Number four, why you? And this is where you need to be ready to brag. You need to be ready to compete. You need to be ready to specifically say, what is it about you that is so different and better that they need to have your services so that they can have those outcomes and that they better pick you. All right? So now, please write down why you. If you're in sales, what is it that you would have as a particular capability as a salesperson that would outsell the next guy that also says he's an excellent salesperson? If you're a nurse, how about your education? That something about your education is, so in your case, Ryan, maybe it is that you had a series of courses that are related to strategic pricing or branding that you particularly with your background in coursework can bring these skills to them, that perhaps you are especially current, that you, because you are a young MBA, that you are very, very up to date with modern technologies.
Right. Right.
So these would be the things that might say, oh yeah, okay, this young MBA is gonna serve me well, okay? So now listen to me do an advocacy talk for one of my clients, and just when I've told you these 1, 2, 3, 4 steps, now you're gonna hear me break the order. And I'm like, oh great, Sue, thanks a lot. You teach me these things and then you turn around and do it differently. Yes, because you'll see after I'm done doing it that if I had not switched some things around, you would have had trouble understanding where she was going. So my client my client helps developmentally disabled children who are on the spectrum of the 13 different recognized disabilities like autism and ADD. I didn't know that there were 13 different kinds, but yes, indeed, there's a spectrum of 13 different recognized disabilities, including the disabilities that are in fact medical, like diabetes or allergies, that sometimes then turn around and look like behavioral disabilities, but in fact were medical disabilities. And she puts together the educational program. She helps the parents find the resources that they need. She does the advocacy with the schools for all those lesson plans. And she, by providing this, some of these families are well adjusted for the first time ever since those children were born. That she can sometimes eliminate sibling rivalry with the quote-unquote normal children, that now she's helped these families become well-adjusted and that these kids are educationally functional, whether it be in their special education classes or in the mainstream. And because she's an RN, and because she has a child herself who is in this spectrum, she has the particular capabilities of being able to identify and take care of these kids' needs accordingly, as well as having been trained, of course, in special education. Now, did you hear me going through the steps? And did you notice that I told you her target audience first? I did that because if I had not told you that we're talking about developmentally disabled kids, and if I just started to tell you about education plans, your brain would have kind of been going to like, well, okay, so teaching in general, I guess, huh? So you wouldn't have really understood where she was going with it. So I want you to mix and match and reverse and utilize these pieces in whatever fashion possible or whatever fashion necessary. So now I'd like you to all take a minute and script it out for yourself. And we're going to go around the room and have everybody give it a try for themselves or for their companies or for a cause that they care about. But I'd like everybody to have a chance to introduce themselves and network here in the room. So give yourselves a few moments. Lots of pens still going, so I'll give you a few more moments. And those of you that finished quickly, I'd love to let you give this a try about a cause that you care about, maybe a charity that you work with, or you know, anything philanthropic. So I'd love you to hear about what causes you care a lot about. A charity, the Heart Association, the Diabetes Association, domestic violence shelter, something. So those, you overachievers that have already come up with your commercial, you can write on. How about a volunteer to go first?
I'll do it.
Okay.
Go, Greg.
Yeah.
Give it a round of applause.
Okay.
Oh, my God. Hands.
Can you sit down in the chair?
Okay.
All right. It'll seem like I'm writing this in the script. Hi, I'm the CEO and owner of Anderson Strategic Business Consulting. I help with small businesses with writing marketing plans, business plans, employee training, and strategic planning. My small business clients come to me with problems and projects they simply don't have time or money for. I provide them with affordable solutions and answers to their business needs. Why should you hire me? It's simple. I'm a college graduate with practical experience in entrepreneurship. Affordable and effective business consulting. Pick me.
Yeah. You chose not to tell us your name.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. Well, I didn't write that in my pitch card.
Yeah. Round of applause.
Yay!
Now, Greg, tell me. No, you can sit down. So, tell me again the target audience, the kind of company that you want help in connecting with, and the right kind of target for you.
My ideal client would be a small business that needs consulting.
But what kind of consulting, please?
Marketing plans, business plans, employee management, or strategic planning.
Yeah, okay. And you said all of those things in that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, good. Okay. Yeah, that one thing that when folks talk too broadly, sometimes the specific hook gets lost. So again, make a strategic decision that I'm making sure that I get across just what it is that the services are that they can use me. Somebody else, and you don't have to stand up and come forward if you don't want to. You can just stay right where you are. Go for it.
Okay. Hi, my name is Doreen Blunt, and I work with nonprofit businesses and issues-based advocacy groups to help them gain recognition for their cause or their issue using the tools of video, print, graphics, and the web. Results that I try to give my clients are that they get recognition, they get attention, and especially for nonprofit organizations, they get what they need in terms of financial backing. So I do a lot of fundraising videos. I'm a professional storyteller. So the reason nonprofits and issues advocacy groups would hire me is because I care about every single story that I tell and I produce. And I craft stories that touch hearts and minds, and they change behaviors and get results.
I should just throw mine away.
And notice that you chose to talk about your target audience first, right? Okay, who's next? Fabulous. Come on, somebody go for it. Yeah, go for it.
It's too good, I cannot.
No, you can go for it, that's good. Let's hear yours.
Yeah, I don't have.
Oh.
I really don't have. I'm a student now.
Awesome.
Well, but see, students. Okay, and I'll get you. Students have many, many things that they can talk about. I do this with high school juniors, and I get high school juniors to be able to talk about what their skills and abilities are. So
okay.
Let me use an analogy that I used in the resume discussion that we had a little, because you were in my resume group, right? That okay. There's a kid who has never worked for money in her life. She has volunteered at the Castaic Animal Shelter and candles the cash, helps people get acquainted with the dogs, helps the families make the matches, cleans the cages, and has gone to Valencia High School. And she's got her different classes that she's taken and things that she's learned and her different activities. But nowhere in her entire life has she been paid to do a darn thing. Virtually no paid work history whatsoever. So now, if I'm the manager of PetSmart and I want to hire a retail clerk, do I want to hire the girl that has retail experience at Hot Topic? Or do I want to hire the girl that has experience working with animals and the people that love animals, experience ethically handling cash, and fearless involvement with the dirt and grime and icky stuff that would go along with handling pets? Which one is my probably better hire?
Second.
Yeah, and that's who they hired her. So even students, you have things that you care about, and I watched you kind of not necessarily understand what I'm talking about. If you are a student and you are not volunteering or serving the community in any way, shape, or form, I suggest you start. Because in your job search, the nonprofits and the advocacies and the causes that you care about may mean everything to where you end up with your career. And I'm involved in so many, I'm not here today as a volunteer. Yes, of course my business is related to this. But I'm here today as a volunteer. So guess what? Then it all just starts to really add in. And yes, they needed volunteers to step up to help out. They can't afford to pay people to come up and stand. So it's volunteerism and it's advocacy. And so if you are not already volunteering somewhere about with something that you care about, domestic violence shelter, something with animals, something with religion, I don't care, find something, okay? And additionally, people without defined work experience, there's almost always studying and reading coursework that's been done that then is marketable, okay? Enough of a tangent.
Can
yes,
I just add something?
Sure, please.
So I don't get jobs. What I do is I keep showing up until they pay me. Seriously.
Yeah.
My internship here at College
yes.
of the Canyons with
yes.
the Small Business
yes.
Development Center where I worked for a year.
Uh-huh.
I showed up for 2 weeks every single day and they said, oh, you're gonna keep volunteers sharing with us? And then they said, oh, can we start paying you? With Ed, did I come into the office and I just said, Ed.
3 days, he's already made commission.
There you go.
So
well done.
And we offered to pay you not to show up.
Yeah. There you go. That's a job. Let's get somebody to go next. Somebody volunteer. Everybody needs a chance.
Hi, my name is Victor Servin. I'm a fitness coach serving the people of Santa Clarita, desiring to get fit, get in shape, lose weight, eat healthier, educate themselves in nutrition, fitness, and living a healthier lifestyle. and achieve their fitness and health goals by strategically applying the fitness guidelines and methods I educate to others to emulate. I've lost 50 pounds. I'm in the best shape, fitness and health I've ever been in my life, and I'm getting better every day, continually and advancing, applying these methods. And I can serve you to achieve similar results and enjoy the process. Thank you.
One question I have for you. You used your own testimonial about having dropped 50 pounds yourself. Intentionally, did you not tell me about any kind of certifications or education that you specifically had? Was that intentional?
Yeah, just I didn't mention it because I'm not a
So now, he did something that I help people in my career service all the time. Sometimes, you know, logic would say that they're going to go hire somebody with a degree. And in fact, it might not be the person with the degree that ends up getting the job. It's the person that's got the more pertinent work experience. So I always tell people, don't hide age, sell experience. Don't hide lack of degree or talk around lack of degree by showing experience and training and skills. So for every person who doesn't have a degree in the field of their choice, there's probably a way that you can show features and abilities about yourself. You know, somebody that's walking around with a bachelor's degree in history, well then why should you be hiring them as your inventory control person? Well, because they probably have the experience and the training and the letter of inventory control, right? And that's what you'd be talking about.
How would that apply a bachelor in history?
It doesn't. So you don't try to just say, here's my bachelor's in history, and say, I've said. It's that you have to turn around and show the relevant background that says, here, okay, I've got A picks and B picks, and I've got conveyor management, blah blah blah. So you show the things that turn their attention away from the inappropriate degree and divert it to what they have instead.
Why would you even mention the degree?
You certainly would still mention it. You would mention that you are a degree person.
Yeah, it's an accomplishment.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You definitely.
You wouldn't be afraid you're maybe overqualified for the job.
No. No.
No matter what the job is?
No. I don't ever dumb things down to the point of hiding a degree like that. I can't imagine in my work with people, I cannot imagine not mentioning. Now, other than in the case of sometimes I've worked
McDonald's?
With PhD. Well, but why are you applying for McDonald's jobs?
Well,
but even if you were applying for McDonald's, a degree shows that you studied for 4 years and achieved something you followed or able to accomplish.
Yeah.
It's a
major
accomplishment,
yeah. My friend, she graduated from the master's degree, and she applied for my job. They said, we cannot hire you because you have so high a degree.
Well, then I would submit that maybe she's not applying for the right job.
She didn't want a part job because she still keeps studying now.
Yeah, well, so I find in my career practice that it's almost never necessary to make oneself seem less than they are. Now, without turning this into an entire resume theory job, which is a whole another
right.
topic, I can certainly talk extensively about, well, why would you say what and when?
Yeah.
And yes, there are people that don't want to, their career, they've got a PhD in something and that's not what they're trying to do. But I wouldn't say bachelor, back to our original question, I wouldn't say bachelor's in history. But if I'm sitting in an interview and somebody says, well, what was your emphasis, then you're going to answer them.
Right.
But on the resume, I certainly would still say bachelor's degree.
Okay. Yeah. I can understand, obviously, getting certified if you're working at a gym. What if you wanted to go into business in your own, and it's okay to not necessarily say it? Because I know a lot of personal trainers at the gym who have the book smarts, but I'm 100% better shape than them, or I see them, they're overweight and out of shape. And no offense to them, but I'm not going to listen to you because I've gotten myself in better shape
right.
because I've got experience. So
and
why should I listen to book smarts over experience?
And you probably shouldn't, and that's your case. That's
mm-hmm.
your whole point.
Mm-hmm.
And so, no, I'm not advocating to you in any way, shape, or form, go get the certifications. I was just making sure you hadn't accidentally missed them.
Oh,
in
thank
case you. Now, that I want the group to understand that you do a pretty careful little inventory of what's presentable about you. But no, you made a very, very good case as to why somebody would want to come and work out with you and emulate what the success that you've had. Yeah. And for every traditional, for every guy that's got the degree and the certification, there's somebody else who doesn't have that but does have the experience and the smarts. And if managed correctly, this person can outmarket that person. Almost always. Now, I'm standing inside an academic institution where they are in the business of selling degrees. So I'm sure they might not, maybe we need to turn the cameras off or something. but certainly the academic mantra would be, oh yes, you need to go out and get XYZ degree. But I work with people, I work with 55-year-old people with no college degrees that are fantastic employable people all the time. Very marketable, because they've got something to offer. And likewise, as per your example, many, many people do not have work experience, but they are still marketable. They still have strengths, skills, and abilities that can be presented to an employer that might beat the person that's got the traditional work experience. Okay? Mm-hmm. Who else can I have? Okay.
Well, I was also just going to say, even if you don't have the work experience, if you're educated, that shows that you're coachable and you're able to learn.
Very much
so. Job.
And internships that you might have had, specific papers that you might have written, case studies and work groups that you might have been part of,
true.
All marketable.
Okay. Hello, my name is Ryan Bellos. I'm a recent MBA grad from San Diego State who specializes in management. And I'm educated in many facets of business, including management, marketing, finance, etc. I'm a people person who would like to interact with people on a daily basis in a business-to-consumer type of business. While I may not have as much real-time experience as other candidates that you may be interviewing, I'm very well educated, hardworking, and self-motivated, and I will succeed at anything that I do.
Excellent. Do you think it was necessary for him to use what I will call a disclaimer?
No.
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 Definitely not.
What was the disclaimer?
Well,
I do not have.
Right. I would tell you that I think that was unnecessary and probably strategically not
okay.
what you would want
yeah,
to
I wasn't
do.
Too sure about
that you want to talk about, I can provide this, I can do this, I can do this. That any time you introduce the can'ts, won'ts, wouldn't, shouldn't,
puts
don't have,
right.
it's the negative mindset and probably not necessary. I almost always tell people, don't disclaim yourself. So, and people will try to come and say, well, you know, I haven't worked in this industry before, but, so there's the disclaimer, blah, 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 but almost never necessary. Almost always some better way to talk that version. The other piece of feedback that I will give you is I think you do have some work to do where you research out the applications of your skill set.
Right.
Because as I listen to you and hear a company that's trying to go through a branding restructuring or an organization that's got some sales challenges or some marketing challenges, that those might be places where you might decide that, okay, yes, now I can feature those things about my skills. And you'll do that by doing a lot of networking and a lot of kind of shadowing with the more people, you know, show, meet somebody and say, you know, could I come and learn a little, kind of like Greg's doing where he just shows up, but all of a sudden Greg will be there and Newmarket Careers going, what are we doing? But indeed,
that's exactly what I do.
But indeed, that you will be able to make connections where you will be able to graciously be invited, that could I come in and learn a little bit more about your marketing group? Or, oh, you say that you do marketing research. Gee, could I come in and have a cup of coffee? What kind of Starbucks do you drink? And can I come learn more about that? So I'd say you've got some job shadowing to do.
Can I make a good point about that, too?
Sure.
Is it about
only if it's a good point, though.
Yeah. It's
he thought it was a good point, too.
Yeah. It's about the networking groups that you guys choose. Like, if you want to be in small-time business or small businesses, hang out with small business owners. Like, if you're looking for an executive position in a corporation or something like that, hang out in a corporate networking event.
Right.
You know, people that will have the money to afford an MBA graduate. For example, you know, if you have a small business that's a mom-and-pop store, they probably don't have $80,000 a year to shell out. So if you hang out with the kind of businesses that do have that kind of money, that do have that kind of cash to pay you, that's the kind of networking groups that you should be
in. Which means that really what you did was went and bought yourself a membership for the ones who come to the club, right?
Yeah. Go play golf.
Go
play golf.
That's a beautifully valid point, although I will add that it's amazing the surprise places that you find the connections that you need.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That indeed it might be your barber who says, oh yes, my sister works
mm-hmm.
with the
That's
vice president of marketing at Nestle.
Mm-hmm.
I have had it happen so often that the connections were magical and surprising. And so do not be elitist in who you think you're networking with. But to Greg's point, make sure you're ready to kind of ask and then see, this is the whole purpose of our little talk today. The more that you're able to position yourself, the more you get your listener to go, oh yeah, you need to meet my brother-in-law that works he's some sort of director of international marketing at Nestle. You know, I don't know what he does, but he does some sort of, and you're going, yes!
Right.
Okay, so many, many connections are thusly made. Who else, any of you that haven't gone yet? Bill,
I'll
will you go for it?
All right. My name is Bill Stratford. I'm a technical support / help desk professional certified on both Microsoft and Novell operating systems with over 13 years experience supporting end users, technician, field service technicians, and engineers troubleshooting connectivity issues and system diagnostics on Hitachi and Ricoh high-speed production printers. My target audience is a mid to large companies requiring computer, printer, and network support for their end users, requiring timely repair, and which minimizes downtime.
Thank you.
Your commercial was so good, I'm going to write down the name of the guy that owns the company that can hire you.
Now, so, he really did a great job and he chose to tell us right down to Hitachi, et cetera, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
So, what can happen positively about that and what could happen negatively about that? What does he strategically get and risk by doing that?
He will isolate some.
He says what he can do, but he might put himself into a box.
Might be too narrow, but on the other hand, it might be the hook where somebody goes, oh my gosh, so you're like a specialist in blah, 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 right? So again, my point is be strategic about the choices that you're making and say, now, is this gonna pin me down? So I'm curious, Ed, what is it about his commercial?
I met him earlier, and he told me what he does, and it didn't pull the trigger for me.
So what did he tell you now that pulled the
trigger? Well, I started thinking about people that I know that may be able to utilize it. Initially, the first name that popped my head was Jason Vasquez, that does computer support and works on his own.
Premier.
And he's a great guy to work with. He gets a job. He needs backup support. But if you do any field work.
I have, yes.
Okay, but mostly it's phone support.
Well, I've done phone support and field.
Okay, because I may have two names for you.
Yeah.
But the second one is that a friend of mine owns a copy company that does do data networks that probably does not have a fully staffed department that does customer support on the phone. And he may have one and may need more people. So, and he's got 80 employees, so it's not a matter of
yeah.
who does he can
afford. So now it's a bigger kind of...
Right.
Okay, you haven't had a chance to go there. Can you?
Sure, I've just been typing in.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Loretta Horn, and I am an independent business owner in the wellness industry with a company called Manatech, and am looking for ambitious people who also desire to own their own business and will partner with me as we prepare to launch our business into Mexico this coming January. After earning a bachelor's degree and a degree in nursing and working for years as a registered nurse in a hospital, as well as various other positions, I have come to realize that working for someone else does little to build one's own dream. Now, my goal is to find others who desire to build their own business and to provide an excellent opportunity for any individual interested in launching their business both here in the United States and also in Mexico in January.
Cool. Very good. Now, the one thing that I would ask of you is that you talked about your degrees, but the hook you didn't give me was that because you've got those degrees, you have some very particular knowledge about the wellness industry.
True.
That make you uniquely. So, but then I kind of, as I listened to her, I thought, well, maybe she doesn't want me that, well, you know, Sue's got a bachelor's in communications with a fine arts minor, maybe Sue, that if you think that I have to have a wellness background. So there's your strategic decision. Because
right.
You have an opportunity to tie your educational experience to your industry.
True.
If you choose
and
to.
What you said is true. I do have that as background, and at the same time, I don't believe that someone needs a background in wellness.
In that, I follow you.
Yeah.
Now, I don't think you had a chance to go for it, so, right?
Would you? I'm not going to.
Oh, okay. Anybody else?
I'll do one.
All right.
I'm not going to stand up. I'm shy.
It's sad. It's very
why
sad.
Why is that funny?
Hi, my name is Ed Bernstein. I own a local Santa Clarita company that offers a discount membership to the people in Santa Clarita. We provide a discount for all categories of business. We have a focus on entertainment and dining, which is most obvious. We also have 500 businesses that are in the non-food and entertainment that we are pushing to promote more effectively. Our customers are local people. We have a large portion of the population, about 30,000, that carry our cards. And it's a recognizable brand throughout the community. And what I provide is great traffic for local businesses and great opportunities for people that are on a strict budget to be able to eat out more often or save money on other services. And that's what I do.
Now we've reached the end of our time where we're supposed to break out and go back to the other thingy.
Or the raffle.
If any of you need me, newmarketcareers.com.